Hello, everybody.
Hi.
Welcome to What's Up Watchtower. I'm Mike.
I'm Robin.
And today we're going to be reviewing the film released by the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society earlier this year, The Kingdom, 100 Years and Counting.
Whoa.
We couldn't resist. There's so much information that is missing from this film. So we're actually just going to kind of show the movie in some clips, not the entire thing, break down our thoughts on it and some research that we've done, some observations that we made, and hope you guys find it interesting.
Yeah.
So let the show begin.
Their kings have had the day, and with them sin and sorrow will forever pass away. For the tribe of Judah's lion now comes to hold the sway. Our king is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Every one of us are well and happy. Every day we're still working away, and we feel as Brother Russell has said, the Gentile times have ended, and their kings have had their day, so we know not what awaits us. May you, day by day, keep close to the Master, and His presence will so cheer you that nothing shall be able to dismay you. Edith Kessler, October 11th, 1914.
So here we are, just a very short, we're at the title screen now, and we've already got a problem. So to expand, because the words were not shown in the movie of what Brother Russell was saying, it's found in the yearbook, 1975 yearbook, pages 72 and 73. And I'm just going to read it, just like it goes. It says, quite a few delegates stayed at Bethel, and, of course, members of the headquarters staff were present at the breakfast table on Friday morning, October 2nd, 1914. Everyone was seated when Brother Russell entered. As usual, he said cheerily, good morning, all. But this particular morning was different. Instead of proceeding promptly to his seat, he clapped his hands and joyfully announced, the Gentile times have ended. The kings have had their day. How we clapped our hands, exclaims Cora Merrill. Brother Macmillan admitted, we were highly excited, and I would not have been surprised if in that moment we had just started up, that becoming the signal to begin ascending heavenward. But of course, there was nothing like that, really. Sister Merrill adds, after a brief pause, he, Russell, said, anyone disappointed? I'm not. Everything is moving right on schedule. Again, we clapped our hands.
Who's going to disagree with him?
Not right there in his place. I don't think so.
Not right there in his presence.
So, just a little more information, you know, that we'll actually touch into it very soon. So let's just keep going.
Yeah, we'll keep going.
At the kingdom's birth in 1914, the Bible students were not exactly sure what was going to happen, but they knew it would be a pivotal year. For decades, they had been singing that the Gentile times were closing and that the kings had had their day. And they had been using every means available to focus attention on this monumental event.
So right here, Samuel Hurd is telling us that at the birth of the kingdom in 1914, the Bible students didn't know what was going to happen, but they knew it was going to be a pivotal year. And we found this to be a little bit of a discrepancy to what was actually being written about it at the time.
Actually, a big discrepancy.
A big discrepancy.
We're actually just going to review some quotes, some pieces taken directly out of the Watchtower publications that show that the early Bible students did have a set of beliefs regarding this time period, mm-hmm. and that they made it quite clear.
Mm-hmm.
So let's just start. And I'm going to start with, this is a book that was written in 1877 by Pastor Russell, called Three Worlds and the Harvest of This World. And it says, the seventh trumpet sounds from August 1840 until the time of trouble, or day of wrath, has ended. Hence, it doubtless ends with the time of the Gentiles and this 40 years of conquest, and therefore sounds until AD 1914, at the end of which Babylon the Great will have fallen and the dragon be bound. That is, the nations will be subdued and the prince of this world is cast out. And I don't think I mentioned it. That's on page 143 of that book.
Yeah. And then in 1894, the July 15th, Zion's Watchtower says, but bear in mind that the end of 1914 is not the date for the beginning, but the end of the time of trouble.
Mm-hmm. And then we can go to another publication, Studies in the Scriptures, Thy Kingdom Come, 1891, page 153, where it says, AD 33 to AD 70 was 36 and a half years. And so from AD 1878 to the end of AD 1914 is 36 and a half years. And with the end of AD 1914, what God calls Babylon and what men call Christendom will have passed away, as already shown in prophecy.
Then we have in 1911 edition of The Time is at Hand, page 239, it says the year AD 1878 clearly marks the time for the actual assuming of power as King of Kings by our present spiritual invisible Lord. So he began his invisible presence ruling in 1878, according to this book that was published 1911.
And then we can go from the actual Watchtower, 1911, June 15th, page 190, where it says, October 1914 will witness the full end of Babylon as a great millstone cast into the sea, utterly destroyed as a system. So we certainly see so far, there's some huge discrepancies in the first 3 minutes of this movie.
Mm-hmm. Right. The growing up, we were always told that same standard line that he gave in this documentary, that they knew something was going to happen, that it was going to be a pivotal year, but they didn't know exactly what was going to happen. Well, they believed that the end was going to happen. That's what they believed. And they believed that since the 1870s. So,
and at that point, they believed they would be raptured to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
That was a real thing back then, and it's stated again and again in the early literature.
Anybody disappointed? Yay, we didn't get raptured to heaven!
Newspapers had carried sermons to millions. Volunteer workers had distributed millions of free tracts. Colporters were zealously preaching. Pilgrims were busy organizing congregations. And the message was expanding globally. But with the end of the Gentile times approaching so quickly, how could so few Bible students reach an entire world? How could they quicken the pace?
So basically what we're going to see in, I don't know, the first 20 minutes or more of this movie, and you can watch the whole thing on your own, because we're not going to include the entire thing while we make our discussion about it, But they're going to discuss the various ways that the technology of the day that they used in order to conduct their proselytizing. So it's very interesting how they are very proud of the way that they have used technology to further their interests as a publishing company. Mm-hmm. But that's basically what it is. They're showing the ways that their evangelizing was done by using whatever technology was available to them at the time.
It is unanimously resolved to use moving pictures in teaching Bible truths. The Lord sanctioned this in His use of word pictures, so this should not be neglected. The Watchtower, July 1st, 1913.
With that resolution, the Bible students were galvanized to present the photo drama of creation. 9 million people saw the photo drama during its first year, a precious message they would not soon forget.
You know, that brings up an interesting point here, that 9 million people saw the photo drama of creation in the first year. There's probably a lot of very good, reasonable, logical explanations for that, one of which being that entertainment, especially in the time period in which this was happening, was scarce.
This was something new. It was a new technology, and people would have been excited just to see the technology. And of course, people were interested in the Bible more so even back then than they are now. And So 9 million is pretty impressive, but considering what was available to people at the time, people would have wanted to see this, just to see something brand new technologically.
Well, it obviously made an impact, but you know, the witnesses now have just under 8 million Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, so just goes to show you, 9 million people may have seen it. How many people became Bible students at the time because of it? We're not really sure, but we know it wasn't 9 million.
From every part of the field has come the cry saying, "What more is there that we can do?" The result is a new magazine under the title, The Golden Age. Joseph F. Rutherford.
So we're 5 minutes into the film, and we're already jumped ahead to Judge Rutherford. It seems like a lot of stuff is missing here. We see Pastor Russell in the very first scene, and that's basically it. He has a huge portion to do with the beginnings of the movement that turned into the Jehovah's Witnesses, and we're gonna talk a lot more about that in really great detail. This video is going to probably run a little long. We're going to be definitely covering the early history of the Bible students and the Jehovah's Witnesses. But just note, that is not present in this film.
They really just whitewashed right over a very interesting historical time in this organization.
It's almost like a time warp. Because we're going to skip from this time period to the real great future really soon. Mm-hmm.
Soon another technique would come to the fore, the radio station WBBR.
Finally, after some weeks of preparations, we were ready for the first broadcast. That occurred on Sunday evening, February 24th, 1924. The call letters were WBBR. These call letters, our enemies said, meant Wicked Buzzes by Radio.
This section is about the radio station, WBBR, that at the time they were still the Bible students, embarked upon. And something that's not mentioned, of course, is that Rutherford actually believed that Jehovah invented the radio for the sole purpose for them to be able to spread the word of God. Mm-hmm. That it was created for them.
I was privileged to be on it. It was a program that was designed as a family Bible study. But even before that, quite a number of years ago, Fred Franz was on WBBR. Imagine him on the air and youngsters listening to him. Good evening, boys and girls. I know it's drawing close to bedtime for many of you, but before you take yourselves to bed, I want to tell you a story.
This just struck me as funny, odd, I guess you could say, that he made such a big deal. Imagine Fred Franz.
No.
Yes. No. Fred Franz on the radio talking to the children. I mean, who cares? I don't know what his point was for emphasizing that Fred Franz was on WBBR. I don't know. If any one of you understood what he was talking about, you can leave a comment. I don't know.
The success of WBBR was met with increased opposition, so other methods were used to keep spreading the kingdom message.
When I was little, we never had an automobile in our home, but these sound cars, big, beautiful cars, but these big horns on top. And when they broadcasted first music, everybody came out to listen.
And every weekend, some of the, what we would call today, elders would bring the sound car in and station it in our yard. And from there, they would play the records for the neighborhood. Every weekend, we had a large group of people listening because of the location they could stay and listen. And there was quite a gathering during that time.
So now we get to the beginning of the sound car. And just looking at these pictures, I think I would probably run out to the street to see what was going on because these cars are fantastical looking. They have the most amazing speakers mounted on the top. I mean, they're eye-catching and they're meant to be that way. And the thing that I noticed specifically that the brother said, they used them to play music first to attract people. Because you got to remember, in that time period, and I'm assuming by the time period of this, it's in the 20s. You know, this is a time when not a lot of people have a radio. Not a lot of people have access to entertainment, to buy records, to see music. So to hear music playing in a time when that just wasn't the average thing, you couldn't just flip on a radio and hear anything you wanted. So yeah, it would get people's attention, and they used this as a proselytizing tool because once they've attracted a crowd by playing music, then they would start with the message.
Interesting too, he said, we didn't have a family car. Well, this was, I'm assuming, close to the Great Depression. Not many people had cars, and here you have all these cars in the fleet that are big and beautiful and fancy and have all these speakers mounted to them. This was something to see for the time.
Well, how many of us have stopped and looked when we see the Google Earth car driving around? Have you ever seen one? I've seen one, and I have checked that thing out because it is so odd, so many cameras on it, so many weird things. So yeah, a vehicle that's very different and playing music and made to get your attention, it rolls by. Yeah, you're gonna see what's up. For sure.
Another time I set up and started one of Brother Rutherford's lectures telling about the second coming of Christ. A few days afterward, a person told me that his fellow moonshiner was set up in the woods making a run of moonshine, when all of a sudden here came a voice from above.
Car mounted up on the, looked like, top of a mountain, just projecting down to the town below. I can imagine that would have been very annoying. You could not get away from whatever was coming through those speakers.
Can you say noise pollution?
We would come up on a porch, open our case, set the arm in position on the record, and push the doorbell. When the householder opened the door, we would say, "I have an important message I would like you to hear." And we would start the record.
It is often said that religion
Woodward.
Is a snare and a racket. And why?
So here we get into a part that is entitled Aaron, because it introduces the phonograph. And again, the Jehovah's Witnesses have made excellent use of developing and adapting technology to suit their needs. I imagine at that time period, if you came to the door with a portable record player, first of all, the person at the house had probably never seen one before. They actually weren't made in great numbers. There's actually an episode of Antiques Roadshow where somebody had one. So it's just very interesting. You know, the certain things that they bring to the fore are attention-getting all by themselves. But the other most interesting part about this is that at that time period, you weren't really required to say anything to the householder. You know, as I said, they would start the record and knock on the door. A person would come to the door, the record's playing, and that's basically it. You may introduce yourself by your name, but you didn't do any talking to the householder.
And I remember they told us, now to help the householder concentrate on the message, it would be good if you would watch the record. So we were told to watch the record go around and around and around.
Some witnesses even nicknamed the phonograph Aaron because it did the talking for us. In addition, placards and information marches had also come on the scene.
And Brother Rutherford, of course, was a shorthand expert. And whenever you talked to him, he'd always be busy writing. You wouldn't know what he'd be writing about. And so he's doing that this day. And so he ripped it off and he gave it to me. He said, "What do you think of it?" And it said, "Religion's a snare and a racket." So I said, "My, that's pretty strong." As a matter of fact, I said, "That's hot."
We'd put on these sandwich signs, you know, that had some kind of a message and slogans on it. And they'd give us a little sign that we carried, you know, on a stick.
And we walked very slowly down the street and then back the other way in an area.
We walked up a street one way and we walked back down the street
the other way.
They would try to not let you think they were looking at you, but they were reading all of the information on the placard.
They looked at us and they were reading our placard. Maybe they were just looking at us like we were crazy people.
They said they wasn't looking, but they was looking.
And I always remember the sister who looked up at the sign that she was carrying. She looked back up over her head. And it said, "Serve God and Christ the King." And she looked at the one in front of her, and the back of that sign said, "Religion is a snare and a racket." She said, "Well, I'm sure glad I don't have to carry that sign." Well, she was carrying that sign. It was on the back of hers. But anyway, she didn't know it, so she was happy.
So just over 15 minutes into this film, we're given a little story of a woman who was in line wearing a sandwich placard, the sign on front, sign on the back, and she was behind someone walking and said, and saw what was on his back, and it said, "Religion is a snare and a racket." And she said, "I'm sure glad I'm not carrying that sign." Well, the brother says, "You are carrying," you know, he said to the audience here, "You are carrying it, it was on your back." Just shows me that while the people's intentions may have been so genuinely motivated, they didn't know what they were doing. She didn't even know what the sign she was wearing on her back said on both sides. How invested in this could you be if you don't even know what the sign you're putting on your body says on the front and on the back?
How, and it makes me wonder, how effective was this form of preaching? You know, they don't say how many people they drew in from these parades and things of marching up and down the street with these sandwich signs on them. So, I mean, it just seems like a lot of wasted energy, to be honest with you.
And keep in mind, too, that as this progression is being made, the new advancements in the ministry that Judge Rutherford was putting forth and implementing, as that's happening, the original Bible students who followed Pastor Russell are gradually fading away, fading away, fading away, because they did not agree as a whole with the changes that he was implementing and the changes he made to Pastor Russell's original plans, the original things that he had set up. So as they are out proselytizing and gaining new members for what they're teaching, they are also losing a great deal of people at this time. And we'll get further into that in the future, but I just thought it was important to make a note.
They had adult-sized placards and they had little fellow placards. Well, I was only about 4 feet tall, but whenever I got there, the little ones were gone. So I only got a big one. It came underneath here, and every time I took a step, I kicked it with my feet, but it didn't make any difference. We enjoyed working with placards.
So here we see an example of a brother saying that he was, when he was a young child, that he was also wearing one of these placards and on the street evangelizing. But as a child, especially a young child, I'm sure they couldn't possibly have had the full understanding of what they were doing, of what they were saying, of what the words religion is a snare and a racket actually mean. So this is just another example of indoctrinating children with beliefs and phrases and propaganda that really alters and affects their views of perception of society and changes their life as a whole.
The next section is basically how these ones that have been in the religion for such a long time, how they got their start in the ministry. And really there was one story that stood out to us, and we just want to share that one story.
Yep.
We had pioneers come to our house and they studied with us, and she decided to get us started in the ministry. We would begin with street work, but I said, no, I said, I don't want to do that. And she said, well, that's too bad, she said, because I can see the Book of Life now. There's the names of your sisters written there. Nola Rain.
For the first time in this video, I see the real Jehovah's Witness organization in her comment.
Mm-hmm. The pioneer sister that was studying with her and her family was basically emotionally blackmailing her, telling her that she could see the Book of Life and that this woman's name was not going to be in it, or wasn't in it. And I just thought, now, if you have any type of reasoning ability, you would know, not even the angels would have known whose name was in the Book of Life. How arrogant for this woman to have pushed this, she would have been a young girl at the time, into doing something that she wasn't comfortable with because they just needed to sell more publications. Mm-hmm. They're still using the same tactics today in their own way. In the regional convention, 2016 regional convention series, where they talk about Kevin. When their message turned from one of witnessing and preaching the good news to one of judgment, Kevin didn't want anything to do with it. And if you watch the video, it was very interesting how they did it, because he was just like, I don't want to bother the people that I work with this. You know, I got to go to work. And he was just like, I don't think that would be a good idea. But they were just showing, you know, how wrong that was, that he didn't want to do that sort of work. And so they're still doing the same thing. And I just thought it's interesting that I'm sure that a witness will watch this video. They won't even pick up on what she just said.
Mm-hmm. It gradually became clear that the individual minister needed further cultivation. So the brothers started perhaps the only school from which not one single solitary person has ever graduated, the Theocratic Ministry School.
Back then, the sisters didn't give talks. The brothers gave the talks. The sisters didn't. We just laughed and giggled at the brothers.
I know we were all very, very excited as sisters when we were invited to be part of the school.
And I remember I was just so excited. I jumped up and was clapping. The sisters behind me were crying. I have to give talks now. They didn't like it. But I couldn't figure out why they were crying. But
this section is all about the implementation of the Theocratic Ministry School. And when the women talk about that they eventually were given the opportunity to also give talks, anybody who's not a witness would probably assume that they were giving talks from the podium the way that the men were. But as we know, as witnesses and former witnesses, this isn't the case. And so it's not quite giving the talk from they're not really ministering to an audience. They're in a situation where they're talking to a householder. And so it's not quite the same thing. And yes, it is good training for public speaking, but that wasn't the purpose. The purpose is to make more converts and to become more effective at making converts.
Mm-hmm. I also wanted to mention that it really stood out to me the way the women in the organization are really stopped from progressing any further in a ministry or ministering type of capacity, especially from the platform. It's like the brothers have made an allotment so that you can have a small piece of participation, but this is as far as it's going to go. Giving the number three talk or being a householder for a number four talk that somebody had when the school was still in that format was really the height of what you could expect to do in the organization itself, aside from being a real workhorse of a regular pioneer, a special pioneer, which is, I think, where the women really took over in the organization. They are the ones that did that work, that hard
still do.
Work, and still to this very day do. Mm-hmm. So I just think it's interesting to note, the women are zealous. Mm-hmm. They're really working hard for this organization, and are they allowed to preach from the platform? Are they allowed to teach from the platform? Nope. We'll throw you a little bone here. That's it. You get the demonstration, the number three talk.
This school would prove invaluable in training God's people to use their gift of speech in proclaiming the kingdom good news. But at the same time, another school was also having a powerful effect on the ministry. The Watchtower Bible College of Gilead. The next several decades would see more new schools and training programs. But it would also witness monumental conventions and groundbreaking new releases. More tools to help God's people stay focused on the harvest.
Well, I was so happy that we're having the convention because the people used to think we were just some little dinky religion, you know. And I knew when the Yankee Stadium was going to straighten them out.
So now we're to the point of the conventions and all the releases that were taking place at that time. And the convention of 1950 in Yankee Stadium. And I really love this little old lady. She's so cute. But I did notice what she said, that she was happy that they were having this convention because she could straighten some people out that thought that this was just some dinky little religion.
Mm-hmm.
The Pioneer Service School, the Ministerial Training School, the School for Kingdom Evangelizers, Special Metropolitan Public Witnessing, a newly designed JW.org, Caleb, and the Become Jehovah's Friend series, the Revised New World Translation. And now, a new language app to further train publishers to learn to speak the pure language in multiple languages. Video on demand, an entirely new website where people can watch morning worship and other video publications. And finally, a return to broadcasting. Our own TV station, JW Broadcasting, taking the Bible's message from world headquarters to the farthest reaches of the planet. Imagine what we will look back on at the 1,000th or 1,000,000th anniversary of Kingdom Rule. The past 100 years helps us to appreciate that God's kingdom is real and that Jehovah God has been using that kingdom to accomplish His will on earth today.
Let's just break down what he said, which really he didn't say anything. He said, the past 100 years helps us to appreciate that God's kingdom is real.
That's an incomplete thought as far as I'm concerned.
How does it prove that God's kingdom is real? That you have made use of the technology of your time to go about your proselytizing and publishing of books, brochures, tracts, and gotten thousands and now millions of volunteers to do that work for you. How does that prove that God's kingdom is real? I just don't see the evidence.
There's no correlation between the two.
Yeah. And he said, and that Jehovah God has been using that kingdom. Jehovah has been using his kingdom. By the way, I thought it was Jesus' kingdom, but that's besides the point. To accomplish his will on earth today. Another incomplete thought that says absolutely nothing other than an organization made up of volunteers have used the technology of the day to spread their beliefs.
But how real is that kingdom to you? Looking back on our heritage and speaking to those with years of experience will make the kingdom more real to you and will prepare you to benefit from that kingdom.
Another sentence that absolutely makes no sense, what he just said, that looking back at your heritage is going to make it feel, is going to make it real to you. How is looking back at your heritage makes it feel real to you?
And as we're going to discuss in just a moment, this look back at their heritage is not that full of a look.
Yeah, and he says, and it's going to prepare you to benefit from that kingdom.
Nothing he says makes sense.
Those sentences don't make any sense to us. I mean, it's a feel-good movie. It's a feel-good, if you're a witness, oh, look at our heritage. It's a, you know, look at all the things that we've been able to accomplish. But it's completely empty of any substance.
Everything that the society has done has been for our good.
We're growing faster today than we ever have.
And I've been very grateful for having Jesus' brothers to take the lead for us.
There is no question about the kingdom being in control.
What else can be more real than the kingdom and the hope it holds?
This is the reality, God's kingdom. Everything else is an illusion.
The kingdom is in control.
Okay, so when you break down this movie, and we have broken it down, and we're getting ready to go over the summary of all the parts of the movie. Mm-hmm. And let's just review what parts were filled with facts and meaty truths and historical accuracies. And then let's just see what else was in the movie that I'm sure you all noticed. So we start out, the very beginning of the film starts with Brother Russell, 1914, Bible students. Mm-hmm. We're given that very short intro that we've already shown is not completely accurate because at that time period, the Bible students believed that the end of this wicked system would be in 1914. They were expecting a rapture at that time. As we get about 2.5 minutes in, it goes over the photodrama of creation. Now, we're told how spectacular it is, how visually stunning it is. It's a word picture. It's new. It traveled around. 9 million people saw it. But not once are we told about the content of that film, what the beliefs of the Bible students were at that time. And the reason for that is very simple. The Jehovah's Witnesses cannot show you that and then say that today everything is different and it's still God's organization, still God's plan, because the content of these things is different than the beliefs of Jehovah's Witnesses today. Very much so. But we're given no shortage of praise being given to the organization, the artwork, the people who went into making it. It's praise, praise, praise for the photodrama of creation, but we still don't know what's in it. Well, you can find that out, but from the movie. Then we go automatically into Rutherford and the beginning of the Golden Age. So we're 4 minutes and 28 seconds into this movie, and already the history of Russell is gone. We're not going back to that. Rutherford, the beginning of the Golden Age. And then at 4 minutes and 50 seconds, there was a really interesting thing that's brought up, and it's the way something is worded. It said the thousands who would participate in that work, speaking of the preaching work, which means if they had to distinguish by saying those who would participate, that means there is another group who would not participate. And they're not talking about that. They're not talking about the schism that happened in the organization at that time of people who did not want to go along with the changes Rutherford was making. 5 minutes in, speaks about the Harp of God and the Study by Mail program, but only emotional type experiences given by a sister talking about how they were typing these cards up and getting these things sent out. And then it goes on to 5 minutes and 20 seconds in, it talks about WBBR, the beaver. And then we talk about the sound car. And then we talk about the phonograph. We're 8 minutes in talking about the phonograph. And then it goes to testimony cards. And again, no content for the testimony cards is shown in the video. We're just told about the testimony cards. Mm-hmm. It goes from there to at 12 and a half minutes, it talks about the time period in which they were in. People didn't have money, so they would often barter for literature, eggs or chickens or whatever. So it just I wanted to mention that to show what the time period was like. People were in a poor state. It starts at 13 minutes to really start going down all the devices that were used in the preaching work. Placards, marches. At 16 minutes, it talks about publisher cards and the field service. At 19 minutes, it talks about the theocratic ministry school. At almost 21 minutes, it talks about Gilead. 22 and a half minutes, it starts talking about the conventions and new releases in 1950. And this is what was very interesting, because the words people used to describe the feelings that they had at the organization are something that would get your attention, because this entire video is really an emotional plea. There's nothing of any hard-hitting substance in it. It's mostly interviews with people that seem like really sweet, nice people, but the entire video is based on their personal feelings about what was happening, and not about truth, not about facts. It was all their interpretation, the feelings that they had during this time period.
But boy, when you would sit in those stadiums and see all your brothers and sisters, it just was so heartwarming and made me feel safe inside Jehovah's organization.
And it was just wonderful. Every time you went to the convention, it was something thrilling.
And when it ended, we didn't want it to end.
The words that they used to describe, it was heartwarming. I felt safe being in the brotherhood. It was thrilling. We didn't want it to end. You know, these are all emotional triggers, you know, mm-hmm. that the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society know very well what they're doing here.
When we were talking about this video, we said that it reminded us of the Carousel of Progress, if you ever remember that ride in Disney World. Now is the time. Now is the best time. Now is the best time of your life. So it's all fluff, really. And it's completely lacking of the actual reality of things that were happening and things that were being preached, things that were being, that were in the publications, that now, if you were to preach them, you would be called an apostate. But the light gets brighter and brighter.
You know, and that just goes right along with this. This movie is about 28 minutes and change. We're already at about 25 minutes here, and a brother says something very interesting. He says that the ministry is reaching record highs.
Yes, he certainly did. He said that it's growing faster today than we have ever grown. Those were his words. Well, you know, there's truth, and then there's truthiness.
I will speak to you in plain, simple English. And that brings us to tonight's word. Truthiness.
So this might be a case of truthiness. It doesn't matter if it's factual. It's how does it make you feel?
It feels like it's true.
It feels like it's true. It feels right.
It makes me feel good to believe that it's true.
Yeah, but is it actually true? Well, we pulled up some information, and this came off of JW Facts. Thank you for all the research that you do. And we'll provide links, of course. But let's just read some of the facts, the factual statistics. It says that American studies show that Jehovah's Witnesses have the highest turnover of any religion, and that the dramatic change in growth directly coincides with the change of the generation teaching back in 1995 and access to the internet. In the 10 years from 96 to 2005, there were 2.9 million baptisms. Yet, the increase in average publishers was only 1.4 million. So this shows a 1.5 million stopped publishing, even accounting for the average death rate, over a million witnesses left in a 10-year period. And then the 5 years prior to 75, this I found very interesting, the 5 years prior to 1975, that the number of publishers was increasing at an average of 15% per year. But during the 80s and 90s, early 90s, growth continued at over 5%. That's still decent. This has fallen, however, now to between 1 and 3%, hardly more than the world's population growth of 1.2%. So a large number of new publishers are teenagers who were raised as witnesses. And this this indicates that almost 2 billion hours of preaching a year only brings enough new people to the Watchtower Society to replace the children that leave. So, had growth rate continued at that 5% in 1995, by 2014, we would have exceeded 14 million witnesses. However, there are still, I guess right around or a little bit less than 8 million as of 2014. So another thing that was interesting was that baptisms reached a high of over 375,000 in 1997. But since then, there has been a rapid fall of 30% to an average of 250,000 per year. So, of gravest concern to the governing body must be the rapidly falling conversion rate, which is the percentage of Bible students that actually get baptized. So this has dropped dramatically, with the annual number baptized compared to the average monthly studies, falling from a high of around 1 in 5, or 22%, prior to 1975, to now nearly 1 in 33, which is a 3%. So, very interesting statistics. He puts a lot of graphs up there and illustrates these different statistics, and there's other ones that we found interesting, but don't have time to cover them all. So the comment that he made that they're growing faster than ever, that's an outright lie.
Yeah, it's just not true.
It's not true.
And we find that if you've spoken to witnesses, they'll tell you the organization is growing faster than ever. They're really just repeating what this guy says, and he's probably just repeating what somebody else said. Nobody is backing it up with numbers, mm-hmm. and they don't want to see the truth,
no.
even about that.
And maybe some of you will know this. I don't know, since we haven't attended meetings or received any literature in the past 10 years, but there used to be a section in the January 1st Watchtower that gave all the statistics, but they leave out statistics that they used to give. And I can't remember exactly, somebody was telling me, but maybe some of you can comment below if you have noticed this, some of the numbers that they no longer provide. That might be kind of interesting to look into as well.
Okay, so after having given our brief review of the film, The Kingdom, 100 Years and Counting, we've kind of looked at all of the topics that were discussed in the film, and a lot of it, as we've reviewed, is mostly personal experiences. It's lacking the hard facts that people want to know about the history of the Jehovah's Witness organization. So what we're going to do now is we've done a lot of research about the history of the organization, and we're going to go through that, and you're going to see how what we've discovered versus what the Jehovah's Witness organization is showing you now, you can really see the lack of information mm-hmm. that you're being given. So I think basically to introduce it, we all know that the founder of the religion we now know as Jehovah's Witnesses is taught to be Charles Taze Russell by the Jehovah's Witnesses. But the most interesting part of that is that he is claimed by another faith, the International Bible Students.
Yeah.
And some of you may not be that familiar with the International Bible Students. Well, that's why we're here. We're going to give you an overview of their faith and how the Jehovah's Witnesses are related to that. So basically, we're going to go over a PDF document that was created by the International Bible Students. We're going to put a link in the description. It is so fascinating. As I was learning about this, I said, okay, Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, JW.org, says, go directly to the source. Go to our website if you want to find out the information about us. So I took their advice, and I went to the International Bible Students website to find out what they believe, what the history of the religion says from their point of view. So the most amazing thing I found at the very beginning, going to the website, Charles Taze Russell. And I gotta tell you, it was a little unusual to see the person you've always associated with Jehovah's Witnesses being claimed by another faith. And that's a copy. I've actually printed it out. The PDF document is entitled, Pastor Russell Founded the Bible Students, Not Jehovah's Witnesses. So this is an effort for the International Bible Students to explain how the Jehovah's Witnesses came about. And these are sources that are listed and referenced in the back. I have double-checked some of these sources and found out that this is all very provable. There's a lot of documentation about it. So let's just get right into it.
Yeah.
Shall we?
Yeah.
So, and I apologize for having to read a portion of this. There's just no way around it. So, early in his movement that began in 1872, Pastor Russell promoted a lapel pin that his Bible students wear to this day. A cross and crown surrounded by a wreath symbolize that Christians, by daily cross-bearing or suffering with Jesus, will gain the crown of life. Then they will share with Jesus in his kingdom, offering eternal life, symbolized by the evergreen wreath, to mankind. Yeah. So, right from the very beginning here, it says, Jehovah's Witnesses do not believe Jesus died on a cross, but rather on an upright stake. Check, that's correct. Mm-hmm. Many Jehovah's Witnesses consider wearing this cross and crown to be idol worship. Yep, they do that. Check. Yeah. So this disqualifies them as being Pastor Russell's Bible students. Now you can say, yeah, that's a very simple explanation. We'll just wait. In 1931, over 75% of the Bible students from Pastor Russell's era had already separated from Judge Rutherford. Therefore, Judge Rutherford observed that neither Russellites nor Bible students were any longer appropriate names for his followers. They passed a resolution that henceforth, they would be called Jehovah's Witnesses. And we know that that happened in 1931. The organization previously known as the International Bible Students was officially named Jehovah's Witnesses.
Yeah, how did this happen? How did they become Jehovah's Witnesses? And what happened to the Bible students?
Good question.
What happened to them?
Well, let's start with the Bible students' history. Pastor Russell founded the Bible students. The new movement had its beginning in 1872 in Allegheny, Pennsylvania, where a newly formed Bible class selected Charles Taze Russell as its pastor. At that time, other earnest Christians were forming independent Bible classes for in-depth Bible study to meet the then rising wave of infidelity. While many cling blindly to the creeds that originated in the Dark Ages, the Bible students emerged to challenge intelligent unbelief and unintelligent belief. Pastor Russell became a leader of thought and activity among these congregations. In 1879, Zion's Watchtower was formed, later known as the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, not to be mistaken with Jehovah's Witnesses. This society did not become the central authority of Bible student movement. It could not, because all cooperating congregations of Bible students held strictly to congregational self-government. The Watchtower Bible and Tract Society was basically a publishing house and lecture bureau that constantly employed Bible lecturers who traveled throughout the Western Hemisphere, some to the far reaches of the world. So right here, we learn a very interesting fact about the Bible students. Each congregation is completely independent. There is no central location or person that is the head of that organization. The congregations are autonomous, although they are interconnected with the other congregations through personal contact and organizing with each other. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they follow the exact same beliefs down to the letter.
Hmm. Interesting too that how they describe the Watchtower Bible Tract Society as their publishing house that basically sponsored lecturers.
Yep.
To go around the world and lecture, is that what it said?
Yeah, that was the purpose of the Watchtower Bible Tract Society. It was a printing house. Mm-hmm. It was based in making publications. That's it. Mm-hmm. The Bible students were the one who did the preaching work and stuff. The Watchtower Society had nothing to do with any of that. It was just a publishing company.
Wow.
So we know that after Pastor Russell's death, Rutherford basically had a hostile takeover of that organization. He then dismissed the board of directors and put himself in a position where he was at the top of the food chain. And he brought in people who were supportive of him to be his underlings. So he had essentially changed the entire structure of the organization after Pastor Russell's death.
Interestingly, before the takeover, he had been dismissed by Russell. They had sort of parted ways in not so happy circumstances. Mm-hmm. And but upon Russell's death, Rutherford saw an opportunity and came in and seized control of this publishing company.
Right. And his new publications that he continued to produce were continuously kind of stepping back the things that Pastor Russell had said and incorporating more of the new belief system and the new doctrines and the new things that was going to be changing within the organization. And I'm just going to read a small portion here. It says, as early as 1917, the exodus from the newly declared sovereign headquarters began. By 1918, one-fourth of the Bible students had left Judge Rutherford. So
a quarter of them had left by 1918.
Right.
Wow.
25%. But they're just getting started. There's a book that is mentioned in this document, and it's written by a man named William Schnell. The book is entitled 30 Years a Watchtower Slave. And the reason this is important is because this is a person who was one of Rutherford's kind of like right-hand men at the time that all of this was going on. And he clearly says that between 1925 and 1931, there was a campaign to purge the rest of Russell's followers from the organization. They were in a massive undertaking to get new people in to follow Rutherford's teachings, people who hadn't had the history of believing Pastor Russell's teachings in already and now having to change with the teachings. So they were really looking for an entire new group of people to come in. Mm-hmm. And by the time 1931 had rolled around, 75% of the people who were originally brought in, who were original International Bible students under Pastor Russell, had left the organization. So you're really dealing with an entire new crop of people. And in 1931, they had made that split official by naming themselves Jehovah's Witnesses.
So essentially, this was a new religion. And by tying themselves to Russell, they gave themselves credibility of not being a brand new religion, even though many of their teachings had already changed by this point of what Russell had taught. So just found it interesting. You know, this is not a part of the witness history that you will find in the Proclaimers book. And, you know, just it's out there, though. The information is available.
Yeah, I think we can kind of start to sum this up by saying, you know, there's so much information. This is a 14-page booklet. It's available for free. We're providing the link for it on the International Bible Students website. I think anyone who has ever been associated with the Jehovah's Witnesses owes it to themselves to take a look at this. It is another side of history that you may have never heard. And
it's eye-opening.
It's
fascinating to anybody who, especially who is interested in history.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And especially because as Jehovah's Witnesses, we were really only given one side of the story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that is definitely something that I was, surprised and shocked to hear the other side of the story. And it comes from the International Bible Students, and they are still around. Their organization is still current to this very day. There's a video link that we're going to attach in the description also. It is a man who is a member of the International Bible Students. He's an elder in one of their congregations in Ohio. And this is a recent video where he is asked about the differences between the Jehovah's Witnesses and the International Bible Students. It's very interesting. I think there's probably more similarities than differences between the two. But what we want people to know is that there's way more and deeper history out there than is included in the original movie we showed that the Jehovah's Witnesses produced.
Yeah, I mean, they stick pretty closely to Russell's teachings. And it seems to me, although I don't know, you know, I haven't actually spoken to one of them, but it seems to me that it's a much more loving and accepting organization, and that I don't think they do any shunning. It doesn't seem like, from how they described their religion, that they do shunning.
Well, the interesting thing is, I don't know that there's a need to shun, because if you have an opinion that varies from the consensus, that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
They believe in freedom of thought, freedom of religious thought. Not every member of their congregation holds the exact same view about every single little thing.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? That doesn't matter to them. That's not important. I mean, it sounds almost like an infomercial for the Bible students here. Look, I'm not telling you to be a Bible student.
No.
I have no connection to this religion or organization in any way, shape, or form. I found it fascinating because, as a Jehovah's Witness, for the greater portion of my life, I knew nothing about the Bible students. Nothing whatsoever. And
yeah, I was just going to say that when you find out the kind of person that Rutherford actually was, based on firsthand accounts, and you can do that research too. You'll probably come across it in some of the links that we're providing.
Mm-hmm.
You really start to understand how the Jehovah's Witness religion evolved into the judgmental, very high controlling organization that it is today.
Kind of started out that way.
Yeah,
high
with
control.
Rutherford, yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it just, I feel like we could go on for another hour just talking about this kind of stuff, but I feel like we're going to have to probably wrap it up so this doesn't get to be like a epic mini-series.
Yeah.
But I really would encourage people just to click on the links we're putting below so that you can see the information that we're talking about. Don't take our word for anything that we say. Please look up the sources. Please look up the information for yourselves. As the witnesses say, make the truth your own.
Absolutely. So this has sort of been a hard topic to put together. It's got so many elements, and you know, we've done the best that we can with wanting to just get it, make this video and get it up. So we hope that you have enjoyed it, and we look forward to your comments. And you guys are always providing us with information of things that we may not have known, or giving us links to things that we want to do more research on. So we really appreciate that. You do give us topics for future videos, and we really appreciate it. And just once again, you know, we just want to thank you guys. We've gotten so much support and encouragement. And, you know, sometimes when you just want to hang your hat and say, I don't know if I want to do this anymore, we really appreciate everything that you guys are doing for us.
Thank you.
Yes, and all the letters that we're getting, you know, we talk about getting personal stories and interviews and articles. We're starting to get article submissions, so we're looking forward to getting some of those up on our website. And sign up for our newsletter, because although, you know, we're not going to bombard you with emails for sure, because we know how that is. We don't want to clog up your inbox. But yeah, we'll be providing some information in the newsletters as well. So anyways, we just wanted to say that about how much we appreciate you guys. And anything else?
Well, I can't think of anything. I mean, I could think of a lot of things, but I don't want to start again.
I know. All right. Well, thanks everybody for watching, and until next time.
See you later.
Bye.